All right, for Hess's Law, the strategy is this. Let's take a look at that problem again. Chapter 7, number 75. So the target equation is this. It's C4 plus half O2 plus carbon monoxide. So this is the equation we want. CH4 plus half an O2 is going to yield CO plus 2H2. All these are gases, so I'm just going to leave off G for gas. Now, when we look at this, the first thing I'll look at is CH4. And so we want to add up the three equations so we get one mole of CH4 on the left side. And so looking at the three equations, all three of them have one mole of CH4 on the left side. And so that means we could use any of those three. So let's go on to the next one. The next one is we need one half O2 on the left side. And so if I look at it, do any of those have O2 on the left side? The first one does. And so the first equation is this. Except it has two O2s, not one half. And so if I want one half O2, then I'm going to multiply the first one by 1/4. So I'll get 1/4 CH4 plus 1/2 O2. This is going to give me 1/4 CO2 plus 1/2 H2O. Now, if I multiply the equation, so rather than burning a full mole, I'm burning a quarter mole, so I'm going to expect half as much energy. So this would be, not half, 1/4, sorry. This would be 1/4 delta H1 would be the amount of heat involved in a 1/4 mole. Okay, so what that does is it gives me the half O2. So now I have a half O2 here, but I don't have a full mole of CH4, but that's okay. It should clear up in the end. Okay, next I need a mole of CO. Which ones have a mole of CO? On the right. The last one and the middle one. You see the second one has it. And so we have a choice there. We could either use the number 2 or number 3. So, since we have a choice, let's go ahead and try number 2. And so what I want is, I don't want 2 moles of CO, I want 1 mole of CO. Oh, if I want 1 mole of CO, then maybe I should use number 3, huh? If you look at number 3 already has just 1 mole of CO. I don't have to do anything to that. And so let's try number 3. So I go CH4 plus H2O yields CO plus 3 H2s. Okay, and this gives me my carbon monoxide. So I have 1 half O2 that's set and my carbon monoxide set. My methane still doesn't quite match, but, and my hydrogen, I need 2 hydrogens, but I have 3 hydrogens. And so the next step, I'm going to try to cancel something out. I have too many hydrogens. And so what I need to do is I need to get a hydrogen, 1 mole of hydrogen on the left. How can I get 1 mole of hydrogen on the left? Well, I could take equation number 3, reverse it, and divide by 3. Or I could take equation 2, reverse it, and divide it by 2. Which one should I use?
The third.
If I use the third, then the problem of using the third is I just use the third for this. And so if I reverse it, then I'm going to undo what I just did with the carbon monoxide, right? And so instead of using the third, I'm going to use the second. I'm going to reverse it and then divide it by 2. If I reverse it and divide it by 2, I have CO plus H2 yields 1/2 CH4 plus 1/2 CO2. 1/2 CH4 plus 1/2 CO. Was it O2 or CO2? Okay, so this is delta H3 as is. Then what I did was I reversed delta H2 H2. If I reverse delta H2, I have to change the sign, because now we're going the other direction. And then I multiplied it by 1/2. And so it's going to be 1/2 negative delta H2. All right, what this is going to do is it's going to cancel out one of those hydrogens and leave me with two hydrogens. And so now I have it set. I have a half mole of O2, a mole of carbon monoxide, and 2 moles of hydrogen. And so hopefully everything else works out. Does it? No. It doesn't work out because, now the carbon monoxide cancels the carbon monoxide. The 1/2 CH4 will cancel out half of those. And the H2O, 1/2 H2O, will leave me with 1/2 here. And so things aren't working out. I got a bunch of CO2s. What should I do next? I got to get rid of the CO2s and then get the carbon monoxide back here. And so, which one of those has CO2? The second one and the first one. And so which one should I use? The second one?
The first.
The first one? I'll just use the second one here, so I'd be undoing what I just did. Let's try the first one. And so if I try the first one, I'm going to reverse the first one, but then I'm undoing the first one too. Right? And so let's try to reverse the first one and then multiply by, well, 1/4 and 1/2 is 3/4 CO2. So I want 3/4. How can I get 3/4? I'll just reverse the first one and multiply by 3/4. And so I'm going to get 3/4 CO2 plus 3/4 times 2 would be 6/4 H2O yields 3/4 CH4. Plus 6/4 O2. So I reversed the first one, so this delta H1 minus, and then I multiplied by 3/4. Let's see if I'm making any progress here. So 3/4 CO2 gets rid of the CO2 here. So that's good. And then, what else do I have?
The CH4.
The CH4. I have 3/4 CH4 over here. I have 3/4 CH4, so the CH4 ends up canceling the CH4. And I have the O2 cancels. So this would be 2/4, and so I'm left with 4/4, which is just 1 O2. Am I getting anywhere, or am I going in circles? I'm going in circles, I think. And so what I need to do is, you know, I need to backtrack and then figure out, you know, where I took the wrong fork. And so rather than going in circles trying to figure it out, this is like the jungle analogy, you know. I went down the wrong path, I'm going to go back and then try to take an alternate fork in the trail. And so I'm going to start from number one again. And then this time, what I want to do is I want to go and try the other way of getting what I want. And so in number one, I have CH4, and I have, well, actually one quarter. I have one half O2. Then I need my carbon monoxide. And what did we do last time? Did we use equation? We used equation 3 for the carbon monoxide last time, right?
Yeah.
Let's try using equation 2 for the carbon monoxide this time. So if I use equation 2 for the carbon monoxide, then I multiply by 1 half. And so I'll end up with 1 half CH4 plus 1 half CO2 yields CO plus H2. And so this is 1 half delta H2. And so that gives me my 1 mole of carbon monoxide. And then I go to hydrogen. Here, hydrogen, I have 1 mole. I'm supposed to have?
2 moles.
And so I need to add an extra mole of hydrogen there. Well, how should I add the extra mole of hydrogen? So let's look at which equations has hydrogen involved, and that would be equation 2 and equation 3. Which one should I try to use in this case?
Equation
3, because if I use equation 2, then I'll just undo the carbon monoxide that I just did. And so I'd use equation 3 and then go on from there. And so the approach for Hess's law, you know, Hess's law is one of those things where if you start getting lost, it's like getting lost in the jungle, and then you back up, and then you try a different path. And finally, you know, given enough time, you're going to find the right path through the jungle. And so, given enough time, these aren't difficult problems. You just keep working on different paths until you hit the right path, and when you hit the right path, then you'll get the final answer. You'll get to your goal. Does that make sense? But this is totally normal. And Hess's law with fractions and all this other stuff, it becomes kind of a pain. And then, you know, dealing with that is a lot of work. And but it's pretty much, they say, par for the course. That is, it's pretty much the way it's done. You just keep trying until you hit it. Okay? So this is a start, so you can finish this yourself. Some of the other Hess's law problems are a lot easier than this. Okay. Any questions on this? I'll let you finish it.
Did you assign more homework like that? Or did you assign like only one or two problems from the
homework? I assigned 3 problems from Hess's law. I figure, you know, once you've done one of these, then that's enough.
Is there more on mastering chemistry?
Yeah. I only assigned 1 problem like this, where they give you all the equations. The other 2, you have to know a bit of additional information, but adding them is a little easier, the other 2. It turns out, you know, this is the easiest way to, this is not the easiest way to determine delta H. We did a much easier way of determining delta H. What do you think the easiest way to determine delta H is? The easiest way of determining delta H is from delta H's of formation. Delta H's of formation is a special application of Hess's law. Do you see all this extra stuff we don't need? Look at over here, we have methane, oxygen, carbon monoxide, and hydrogen. We don't need water. We don't need carbon dioxide, right? We have all this extra stuff that we have to get canceled. But for formation reactions, it's easy to get the extra stuff canceled because you always have the same extra stuff. In formation reactions, the definition of formation is a reaction is formation of 1 mole of substance from the elements in their stable states. And so all the extra stuff in formation reactions are the elements. And so those automatically cancel out, and therefore we have a much easier equation to solve. We don't have to do this. This is much harder than using formation reactions. Using formation reactions, we just sum up the delta H's of formation for the products minus the sum of the delta H's of formation for the reactants, and then we're done. And so did we do that for glucose? Did we do that problem yet or not? We did? And so you see getting the delta H for that reaction was quite a bit easier than using this method. Once we have a delta H, you know, then we can use it. You know, we could use it to do stoichiometry like in that glucose problem. And so chapter 7, when you think about it, what did we have in chapter 7? We had heat, right? We had heat associated with objects. We had heat associated with reactions and processes. Heat associated with objects is equal to amount times C times delta T. Heat associated with reactions or processes is equal to amount times delta H or delta U. Delta H for constant pressure, delta U for? Yeah. And then we talked about delta U and delta H. Delta U deals with the internal energy, which is also known as the total energy, being the sum of the potential energy and the kinetic energy. We talked about potential energy. Is that something easy to calculate? No. Kinetic energy is. And so we don't calculate delta U from U final minus U initial because absolute internal energies aren't determined because potential energies are difficult to calculate. Instead, we calculate delta U accurately from Q and W, you know, using the first law of thermodynamics, this first law. Energy is neither created nor destroyed, just exchanged. And then we realize that delta U is not the most useful for us. Delta H is much more useful, right? Delta H would be the amount of energy available. We called it the net energy, right, rather than the gross, because there might be a tax or bonus or no tax on the total energy. You guys recall that? And so we had some stuff about delta U and delta H. Then, since we're interested in delta H, what are the ways of determining delta H? Delta H can be determined from calorimetry. What type of calorimetry? Yeah, but what type of constant pressure calorimetry? There are two types of calorimetry, constant pressure or constant volume calorimetry? Constant pressure calorimetry. But if you do a combustion reaction, you know, combustion reactions don't do good in styrofoam cups. And so when you do a combustion reaction, you would do it typically in a bomb. And so if we do it in a bomb, we're not going to get delta H directly. We get delta U. And then we convert it into a delta H. So we did that, converted delta U into the delta H. And then then we'll have delta H we can use to do calculations with energy. But doing calorimetry is a pain, so, you know, given the choice, my first choice for determining delta H would not be calorimetry. My first choice for determining delta H would be to use Hess's law with delta H's of formation and appendix D. If I don't have the delta H of formation values, then I have to use this type of Hess's law. This type of Hess's law is a pain because we got to get everything to cancel out and everything to add up right. With delta H's of formation, it's easy because it'll automatically add up right because everything's got to cancel. You know, atoms are neither created nor destroyed. And the atoms will cancel because we're canceling out the elements in their standard state. The ultimate goal is to have delta H, because once we have delta H, then we know how much energy is released or how much energy is absorbed. Now that energy is the amount of energy minus what? The natural work of the chemical reaction. The natural work of the chemical reaction is P minus P delta V of the system work, P delta V work. And so that type of work is unavoidable. And so the rest could be released as heat, but it need not be heat, right? Because we could convert that into, or we didn't have to make heat, we could have made work, just not the P delta V work, which is already factored in. And so delta H has factored that in, but as we saw with the glucose, we could use that rather than making heat to make additional work. So there's going to be some stoichiometry problems in the homework as well, and then foods and fuels at the end. So in an effort to save some time, I'm going to skip ahead to chapter 8. So that was chapter 7, kind of a brief summary of chapter 7. Chapter 8. Let me summarize the whole chapter first. Then we'll look at specific points in the chapter. Chapter 8 deals with quantum something. There are a lot of names given to it. You know, quantum mechanics. Or quantum chemistry, or quantum theory. And so what's the difference between quantum mechanics and quantum chemistry? And chemistry you do by machine? One is more physics, one is more chemistry? That's probably pretty good. Basically, they're all the same. You know, quantum chem, quantum mechanics, quantum theory, quantum physics. I left one out for you for this. Quantum physics. That's all the same stuff. It's all, you know, theory. And so let's review, talk about theories in general. You know, what is theory development doesn't always have to happen this way, but I'll tell you, you know, most of the people I was working with, in fact, everybody I was working with, and everybody on our floor and everybody in the building was doing pretty much the same thing. And what was it? What was the thing that we were doing? Well, it was scientists. And what do science? What do scientists do? Well, let me tell you. If you were to ask most people on the floor, what do you do? What they do is they observe nature. You know, scientists just observe nature because they observe nature to look for patterns, right? They want to see patterns. And it was interesting because not just physical scientists, but, you know, but social scientists do this as well, because I was listening to a TED talk about a social scientist, and she was looking at human behavior and why humans do certain things that they do. And so she said she went into data research mode. And she went into data research mode, which is locking herself into her room or whatever, something like that, and poring over all the data, looking at all the observations they had collected, right? And then looking for the patterns in that. You know, all these people had a certain trait, and she wanted to see, was there some kind of pattern to it, or was it totally random? And so, make a long story short, she saw a pattern, and then she hypothesized that this pattern was connected to this behavior, and then she came up with some kind of social behavioral theory that, and it was pretty interesting because I thought, wow, that's exactly what we did, exactly what I did. You know, I observe, take lots of observations, and look for patterns. and trend. And then from these patterns and trends, we come up with laws. These laws are called empirical laws. Empirical laws are just these empirical equations. Empirical equations are usually mathematical formulas that fit the pattern. Now, what is an empirical law or empirical equation or empirical observation? Have you heard those terms? They're very common. And empirical just means, do you know what empirical means? It means by observation or by experiment, if you will. In other words, we can think of a law, the ideal gas law. Where did the ideal gas law come from? Did the ideal gas law come from a hypothesis? Did the ideal gas law come from a theory? No. You know what the ideal gas law came from? The ideal gas law came from observing how gases change under certain conditions, you know, temperature, pressure, moles. From those patterns, usually just graphs, simple graphs, they came up with the law, the ideal gas law. The ideal gas law is an empirical equation, that is, it's a mathematical equation that fits the pattern. It's a very simple linear pattern. So. And so the ideal gas laws is exactly this first part of the scientific method. Could you have derived the ideal gas law from theory? Maybe, yeah. But do you think the people who developed the ideal gas law derived it from theory?
No.
In fact, the ideal gas law was known before atoms, you know. And so here, it's just empirical law. It fits it. But a law is not enough. Just because you have a mathematical equation that fits the pattern, you know, do you really understand how nature works, how nature operates? No, you want a deeper understanding of how it operates. The deeper understanding comes from, well, we had a hypothesis. The hypothesis is that gases consist of empty space with these tiny particles. These tiny particles are moving. In other words, that led to something called kinetic molecular theory. And using kinetic molecular theory, then you could actually go back and derive the ideal gas law from just the theory. But we didn't do that, you know. And so from laws come hypotheses, because you want a little bit deeper than just, hey, it fits this mathematical equation. And that leads to theory. And what do we want? What's the ultimate goal? The ultimate goal is a good theoretical understanding of nature. Because if you understand how nature operates, you know, you just watch, and then you can make, yeah, or predictions. You can make predictions. We'd like to be able to predict, right, phenomena. And so the same thing. This person came up with this theory of this human behavior so that they could predict, right, the type of people who are going to display this type of behavior, I think. So this is our basic scientific method, just as a review. And this is Chapter 8. Chapter 8, let's talk about the development of quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics is a theory, you know, that's what we have. And so we're going to talk a little bit about the development of quantum mechanics here. Where did the quantum theory originate from? Quantum theory originated from observations, and these were unusual observations. The observation was, unexpected or unusual light patterns. I'll just say unusual light patterns.
unusual light patterns.
I'll talk about it usually. What do I mean? I'm gonna talk about it in a little bit. But it started, the observation was there are some light patterns that were unexpected. Why? I'll explain it later. And so yes, there were patterns. And then these unusual light patterns, for example, the hydrogen lamp could be fitted by a mathematical equation. We could call it the law, call it the Rydberg law, or the Rydberg equation. The Rydberg equation is just an empirical, mathematical, and algebraic equation that fits this pattern. So we see a pattern of light, and somebody figured it out. Oh, there's a mathematical pattern here. And I came up with this, the Rydberg equation. So the hypothesis there was that, I'm going to jump, there are lots of gaps here, but we'll fill in the gaps. The electron energy in atoms is quantized. What quantized mean is that there are forbidden energies and allowed energies. Not continuous. Continuous means that all energies are allowed. We see quantization in lots of different things, not just energy. One thing that's quantized would be like the floors of a building. The floors of a building are quantized in this way because there's a first floor, second floor, third floor, right? But it's not continuous in this way. Let's say I didn't want to stop at the second floor. I'm on the first floor. I want to go to the 1.5 floor. Is there a 1.5 floor?
No.
No such thing. And so that would be quantized. Some things aren't so obvious. You know, one of the things that's not obvious is, let's say you had a cup of coffee and it's almost perfect, the sweetness. Let's say you take sugar. I put one sugar cube into my coffee, but I just want it just a touch sweeter. And so what I want to do is I want to put 1/2 molecule of sugar in, because I think a full molecule would make it a little bit too sweet. And so I just want a half a molecule of sugar. Is it possible to put a half molecule of sugar in? No. In fact, it's quantized. Sugar molecules are quantized because I can put one sugar, two sugars, but I cannot put 1.5 sugars. Does that make sense? You don't notice it because how difficult is it to break off one sugar molecule off a sugar cube? That's pretty much impossible, right? And so you don't notice it because it's so small, it appears to be continuous. It appears that you could make or adjust your coffee to be any sweetness you want, but in reality, you can't. In reality, the sweetness of your coffee occurs in steps of one sugar molecule. Yeah, forbidden would be, you'd be forbidden from adding a half a sugar molecule because it just doesn't exist, a half a sugar molecule, right? Let's say you only have enough money to buy a half a car. Can you say, I'll take half the car or something? No, it just doesn't exist. You'd have to come up with a full amount, otherwise that would be not allowed. And so we see quantization in a lot of things, right? We just don't notice it sometimes because things appear to be continuous, like sugar. Or the same thing with salt. You know, you can't have any amount of saltiness because it's going to come in increments. But the increments are so small, it appears to be continuous. All right, and then electron energy in atoms is quantized. That was the hypothesis. And the theory that came out from this is called the Bohr theory. Bohr theory, he looked at things called orbits. He said electrons orbit around the nucleus. But it turns out that a theory, you know, is the theory really the ultimate? Yes, the theory would be the ultimate in terms of understanding, but what if, you know, what if, you know, it didn't agree with experiment? If a theory, you have the fight between theory and experiment, and they were conflicting. So which one would you believe? Would you think you did the experiment wrong? Maybe. And then you repeat the experiment, but you keep doing the experiment, and then you keep getting results that conflict with theory. And so ultimately, you know who wins? If there's ever a fight between theory and experiment, who wins? Experiment. Right? Because if the theory cannot describe what's happening experimentally, then it's not a very good theory. Well, that's what happened with Bohr theory. The Bohr theory, it couldn't describe anything more complex than pretty much a hydrogen and some other. Unusual species. And so basically we'll call this theory one. Theory one was abandoned. People just dropped that because a theory has to agree with experiment at the very least, and then a theory has to predict. And the Bohr theory could not do that. And so what happened was not everything in the Bohr theory was dropped, but a lot of it was, and then some new stuff was added, and we get theory two. Theory twos are modern day understanding of chemistry, and that is quantum mechanics. In quantum mechanics, we don't think of orbits, we think of orbitals. And so these orbitals are critical in understanding how chemistry works. I was watching another show about these physicists. There's a bunch of theoretical physicists, and they have some worry in the back of their mind because the theory that they're working with now seems to fit the experimental data pretty well. But what keeps them up at night sometimes is the thought that maybe somebody is going to do an experiment that proves their theory wrong, you know. And so that's possible. I mean, so quantum theory has been incredibly successful and has made a lot of predictions. And people have tried to prove it wrong, but haven't been successful. It's like the laws of thermodynamics. Have you heard about the laws of thermodynamics? Laws of thermodynamics are just empirical. Laws of thermodynamics, when they first came out, they were just empirical equations, right? Just based on observations. And there's no theoretical. Now people can derive it from theory, but back then there's no theoretical. There's no theoretical basis for that. And so those are called. You know what those are called? Postulates. Have you heard of postulate? Taken without proof. There's no proof, right? And so a lot of people have been trying to disprove it for hundreds of years, but has anybody been successful? No. Has, you know, this whole thing about energy, well, actually, we have to look that into that a little bit deeper, but, you know, there are certain laws of thermodynamics. A whole bunch of people have claimed to make a perpetual motion machine. Have you heard that? Where you can create energy out of nothing. And so energy comes out, but no energy has to go in. okay, or it doesn't come from any kind of potential energy. But that hasn't been successful. But anyway, quantum, this is a state-of-the-art theory. It's not to say things don't evolve, because things could evolve from here, right? Things could get more detail. For example, one thing with quantum theory is that people realize, oh, what about the theory of relativity? How does that fit in? Well, if you incorporate that, then we have something called relativistic quantum mechanics. And so it's not to say things evolve, but this is our state of the art here, modern day theory of chemistry. We know the theory, but is it easy to use the theory? Is it easy to make predictions? And what's your feeling? No. Why? The math is too complicated. You know, you get these equations that are so difficult to solve. In fact, pretty much impossible to solve exactly, so you have to make approximations to solve these things, even with powerful computers. And so, yes, we have a theory here, but it's not so easy, and so we still rely heavily on experimentation and observation. Well, there was another, have you heard of the classical physics, theory of physics there? You know, Newton's laws. You think, where did Newton's laws come from? Did Newton's law come from theory or from? They came from observation, right? All of Newton's laws. Newton was good at observing nature, and he's very careful in measuring things, you know, in the experiments. And so, those. But what is the theoretical foundation for Newton's laws? What do you think? Because Newton's laws are Newton's laws, just mathematical equations derived from some pattern. The pattern of a falling pen or apple or whatever. Right? You can do some calculations. You can predict if it fell from a little higher, how long would it take? You know, those are patterns, mathematical. What's the theory underlying Newton's laws? Well, actually, you know, physics, you don't have to have physics, but this is something to think about if you've had physics. Have you had physics? If you had physics, tell me what the theory underlying Newton's laws is. Because I can use them. You give me a mathematical and algebraic equation, I can figure it out, you know. Also, to properly use Newton's law, you need calculus. But anyway, well, did you know that you can derive Newton's laws from quantum mechanics? From quantum mechanics, you can derive Newton's laws. Is that interesting? Maybe, maybe not. actually, speaking of observations, you know, I just saw on the news this morning or yesterday, the world record in cold. Somebody asked me, you know, what's the coldest temperature? Did you see that, Kelvin? This is incredibly cold. A block of copper, they cool down to some, like, a fraction of a Kelvin, a tiny, tiny fraction of a Kelvin, which is amazing. Well, I wouldn't want to touch that block, you know. Just freeze, finger. Okay, so let's go on with this, and then let's talk about some points in here. And so, unusual light patterns. Let's start off with that. So we need to talk about light a little bit, and not
the duality thing.
No, that's not the duality thing. It's much simpler. You guys saw unusual light patterns, but did you recognize that they were unusual?
Yeah.
You know, all the observations you did with these lamps showed unusual light patterns. Why were they unusual? And so let's talk about light and how light interacts with matter. And so when we think about light, what is light? Light is electro stands for what is electro? Electro stands for electric fields. I'll talk about that in a minute. Electromagnetic radiation. Magnetic, just magnetic fields, electric fields, and radiation. This propagation of electric and magnetic fields. And so when I think of electromagnetic radiation, what I visualize is, I visualize an electric field that oscillates like this, you know, as a wave. In electric field, we have a positive and a negative fluctuation in the field like this. And so it goes positive, it goes negative, it goes positive, negative. Perpendicular to this, we have the magnetic field. And rather than positive, negative oscillations, in the magnetic field, we just go, you know, north, south, north, south. And so when I think about a magnetic field, I just think, okay, one time I have north here, and then it goes south, north, south, north, south. And I think of electric field, positive, negative, changing the, you can think of as the charge. And there's radiation. And this light radiation is traveling. So we have this electric magnetic field traveling through space. And do you know how fast it's traveling?
Extremely fast.
Extremely fast. The speed of light. Which I thought was extremely fast. I thought the speed of light was so fast. But then I heard something. I heard something that, you know, if you have communications using, I don't know what frequency or type of radiation they use, but they're talking about if there was, like, let's say a Mars colony and they were communicating with Earth. Did you hear this?
Yeah.
Like on NPR last week or the week before or something like that. They're talking about how long. So if somebody says hello on Mars and that signal's moving at the speed of light, how long would it take to communicate? And so they're saying something like, it would take 40 minutes to travel from Mars to the Earth at the speed of light. And so if somebody says hello, you'd wait 40 minutes and then you hear hello, and then you say hello back, and then they'd have to wait another 40 minutes until they hear hello back. And so then they're talking, how are you going to communicate when there's a 40-minute gap between everything you say? And so that kind of put speed of light into perspective, but still, speed of light is blazing fast, so I don't know how to think about it now, you know. But I guess Mars is just very, very far away. But the speed of light is not infinitely fast. Speed of light is 2.998 or 3.0. Times 10 to the 8 meters per second.
Yeah.
And so 2.998 or 3.00. I guess we'll just go 3.00 times 10 to the 8 meters per second. And so, in other words, this is what this says. If you let the light shine on you, what do you feel? Maybe you don't feel this, but if the light comes at you, it's moving at the speed of light.
Right.
Do you really feel that impact? No. But what would you feel? Well, one thing you'd feel is, if this is moving at me at the speed of light, I'm going to see negative, positive, negative, positive, right? Negative, positive. And it's moving at me, so it's fluctuating like this. And so one of these, so I start off at negative, and then it moves to positive and goes back to negative. That's called one cycle. And that one cycle is given by, how fast this, we call this a wavelength, right? This peak-to-peak distance moves fast. How many of these peak-to-peak distances move past you in 1 second? And so we have lambda. Lambda is the wavelength. And then we have nu. Nu is the frequency. Lambda is the wavelength. And so the shorter the wavelength, the higher the frequency. The longer the wavelength, the shorter the frequency. And so if there's long distances, then it's going to be moving slower, oscillating slower. If it's a short distance, because all these waves move at the same speed, it'll be oscillating faster. Now, I'm going to ignore the magnetic fields, because magnetic fields, you know, if you're a magnet, you'd be flipped back and forth like this. I'm going to ignore the magnetic field, and let's talk about the electric field. If the light hits me, and there's an electric field, like positive, all of a sudden it's positive, the next moment it's negative. Positive, negative, positive, negative. It's moving like this. And so it's moving at me, boom, 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 boom. What's it going to interact with in matter? So matter consists of atoms. Atoms consist of, let's start off with neutrons. Atoms consist of neutrons. Will the neutrons be attracted to positive or negative?
No.
No, they're neutral. Atoms consist of protons. Would the protons be attracted by positive and negative interactions? Sure. Yeah. Right, because protons would be repelled by positive and attracted by negative. But protons, the problem with protons is they're heavy. They have a lot of inertia. And so they don't necessarily interact with light like this, you know? How about electrons? Electrons, are they heavy? No, electrons are very light. And so normally when light interacts with matter, what does it interact with? Does it interact with the nucleus? This nucleus, which contains the protons and neutrons, is pretty massive. No. When light interacts with matter, it interacts with the electrons. And so if you're a little electron, this is like being a little tiny boat in heavy seas. You know, the little tiny boat is going to be oscillating like this with the waves. Whereas if you're a gigantic ship, you know, would it be oscillating like the nucleus? It's not going to oscillate, you know, the waves are just going to cut through. And so this is why when we're thinking about light and matter, we think electrons. And then we got to think about the frequency, because electrons can be pushed around fast or they can be pushed around slow depending on the frequency. High frequency, the electrons are being violently pushed. Low frequency, less so. Does that make sense? And so let's talk about the electromagnetic spectrum in terms of wavelength, frequency, and one more thing, energy. And so if we look at the electromagnetic spectrum, let's go increasing lambda, increasing wavelength. And so some of the shortest wavelength stuff would be, what light has some of the shortest wavelengths or the shortest wavelength? What type of light? The shortest wavelength light?
Gamma
rays. Gamma rays have an extreme, in fact the wavelength is so small, it's smaller than an atom, you know? Tiny, tiny wavelengths. The gamma rays. Very short wavelength means very high frequency. High frequency. Okay, high frequency also means high energy or low energy, because it turns out that energy is going to be proportional to frequency and inversely proportional to wavelength. And so if we have high frequency, that electron is oscillating quite fast. And so we got short wavelength, very tight, these waves, this. The electron is like this. What's going to happen? The electron is going to start oscillating so fast, you know what happens? The electron starts oscillating so fast that it gets knocked off the atom. Knocked off the molecule, or knocked off from the matter. And so we call gamma rays ionizing radiation. Why? Because they can knock electrons off matter. Ionizing radiation. okay, what has a little longer wavelength and is not oscillating as rapidly is X-rays. But X-rays still have enough power to, or enough energy to, or enough frequency to knock electrons off the atom. So X-rays are also known as ionizing radiation. And then we get to UV. Do you think UV is considered ionizing radiation? No. UV is still oscillating quite fast. It has a fairly short wavelength, but it's not enough to knock the electron off. But it is enough to break bonds. And so UV, when we think about what UV does, is it breaks bonds in most matter. This is why, you know, you hear UV damage. UV damage is you're breaking bonds. You're breaking bonds and that's not good for matter. And then comes visible light. Hopefully visible light is not enough to break bonds, right? Because most of the solar spectrum, when you guys looked at the sun, was visible, what we call visible light. And visible light is made up of a number of colors. At the short wavelengths of visible light, we have what color? Okay, and so visible consists of, at the short wavelength then, next to violet. Next to violet is violet, and then indigo, and then blue, yellow, orange, green, yellow, orange, red. So this is the visible spectrum. It's Roy G. Biv, spelled backwards. I wrote it like this because we're going from short wavelength to long, high energy to low energy, high frequency to low frequency. And so the easy way to remember it is Roy G. Biv in terms of energy. But we're doing it in terms of wavelength because the SpectroViz Plus on the LabQuest 2 system is in terms of wavelength. Is violet enough to break bonds if you expose yourself to violet? No. When you drop into ultraviolet, it is. Okay, and this is the visible spectrum. This is what we can see. We can't see ultraviolet. But once we go past red, we can't see that either. What's past red?
Infrared.
After infrared comes microwave, and then radio, and TV. All right, what does visible light do? If it doesn't break bonds, then what does it do? Visible light. Well, you know, with ultraviolet, you have enough to break bonds. With visible light, it's not enough to excite the electrons enough to break the bonds, but it is enough to excite electrons in matter. And so what happens is the electrons get excited, but not excited enough to break bonds, not excited enough to leave the matter that is ionized. And so we can just excite electrons in matter. And so that's what visible light typically does. How about infrared? Infrared is not really enough to excite electrons up to, you know, these electrons get excited, but they don't leave, the bonds don't break. But what infrared does is, if you think about a bond, do you guys know what a polar bond is? Right. A polar bond has a positive end and a negative end. And so what happens is, if you have infrared like this, and you have a bond that's negative and positive on opposite ends, then as the wave, the oscillating wave comes by, the oscillating wave is negative, positive, negative, positive, negative, positive, right? what's going to happen to the bond, the atoms in the bond? The atoms in the bond are going to start oscillating with the electric field. And what that causes is it causes vibration. And so infrared is enough to vibrate bonds. Actually, vibrate polar bonds. But I'll just say vibrate bonds. And so what we get are molecular vibrations. Some bonds, molecules. Because the way molecules vibrate, since they're multiple bonds, is they have, you know, this vibration couples with this vibration and makes a new vibration type thing. And so bonds slash molecules. Microwave, unfortunately, is not enough to vibrate bonds. Microwave is a much lower frequency. And so microwaves, you know what? You have, not only do you have polar bonds, but you have polar molecules. In polar molecules, like water, one end of water is negative, the other end is positive. And so with these fields, what can happen is the water molecules can rotate, right, with the field, depending on how the field is oscillating. And so what microwaves do is they rotate molecules, small molecules. And so it's enough energy to rotate those. How about radio? Radio is not enough to rotate. What do radio? Radio waves are long wavelength, low frequency. It's a low frequency. How do radio waves interact with matter? Can radio waves pass through the walls of this building, do you think?
Yeah.
Yeah? Yes. The radio waves don't really interact with the walls of this building. What do radio waves interact with? If you wanted to make a radio antenna, what would be the best material? Would you use brick to make it? Because brick has a lot of electrons. The brick would be too heavy. Something that would be lighter would be plastic. Plastic would be very light. I'd like to make an antenna, a radio antenna, out of these two plastic pens. Is that going to work well? It's not going to work well. Why? Because the electrons are kind of tightly held in here. And radio waves just isn't going to give it enough push to do anything. Whereas, you know what would work well? Metal. You know, make your radio antenna out of metal. Why? Because in metals, electrons are tightly held or loosely held? Loosely held. And so if electrons are loosely held, then radio waves, which are more gentle, can just cause them to oscillate. And so in other words, radio waves, this excites electrons in metals. Right? You don't want to get them too excited, because if you get the electrons too excited, what's going to happen? It could ionize. Do you want to put your metal, let's say I want to warm up my metal in the microwave. Is that a good thing to do? No. Probably. And so this is the interaction of light with matter. And so let's talk about why we expect certain light patterns from this. So the thing I want to talk about next is has to deal with metals. Do you think the electrons in metals are easily excited or difficult to excite? The electrons in metals are easy to excite, right? By shining, I can shine light on this. There are other ways of exciting electrons in metals. So I have this piece of steel here from the spatula. And one way of exciting the electrons in the metal is by heating it up. You know, you get more kinetic energy. So let's heat up the electrons in the metal. So if I heat up the electrons, you know, pretty soon this piece of metal is going to get hot, right? But does a hot piece of metal look like a hot piece? Yeah, I can't tell the difference between hot metal and cold metal because it looks the same, right? But if you put your hand around here, you'd feel heat being radiated. And actually, you know what that heat is? That heat is actually electromagnetic radiation. That heat is called infrared radiation. And so you know what I just did? I excited the electrons and gave them enough energy, like infrared, and they can't stay excited forever. These electrons have to calm down, go back down to what we call the normal relaxed state, which is the ground state. And when they calm back down, energy is not destroyed. Energy is going to be released to the surroundings. And that energy is going to be in the form of infrared electromagnetic radiation, or photons. And so you can't see it, but you can feel it. And so your hand is a good infrared detector, right? Your eyes aren't. Well, I'm not going to stop there. Well, let's flip off the lights here. I'm going to, what's the hottest part of the flame? Tip of the cone, so I'll just put it right here at the tip of the cone. Now the metal is glowing. It's glowing red hot. It's glowing red hot. That tells me I'm not just emitting infrared, but I'm also emitting visible light, red light. And so what I've just done is I excited the electrons in the metal so much, like they're like this, that when they relax back down, they emit red light. And so let's heat this up. After red comes
orange.
And so do you see this is starting to glow more red-orange? Red-orange and then yellow. And so I'm going to add red, orange, and yellow, and then green, and then blue, and then indigo, and violet. Once I excite the electrons that hot, you know what color it glows? It glows white hot. Have you ever seen a white hot piece of metal? A white hot piece of metal is emitting all colors of the rainbow because when you add up all those colors, you get white light. I'm not going to heat the spatula to white hot because I don't want to damage it. But if I keep heating this, I'll go beyond violet. What's beyond violet? Ultraviolet. And if I keep heating it up, then I should not only start emitting ultraviolet, but I should also start emitting X-rays, and then finally gamma rays. But I should stop well before then, or it'll probably melt before I get there, right? Okay. So this is well known. This is not an unusual light pattern, right? In a way. This is your normal light pattern, and in fact, the problem with this, if I use this as light bulb, is we don't want to use a flame to heat it up. You know what we could use? We could use an electric current. When you pass an electric current through this, it's going to generate heat, which is going to excite the electrons and start emitting light. But the problem with it is when it gets hot, the metal starts to discolor. You know what that discoloration is from? Oxidation. We don't want the metal to be, this is stainless steel, by the way. Stainless steel is very resistant to oxidation, but other metals are not. You know? And so this led to this. How do we prevent oxidation from occurring, you make sure there's no oxygen. And so what you do is you surround the piece of metal with a gas that contains no oxygen. And so what's a cheap gas that contains no oxygen? Just nitrogen. So you fill this up with nitrogen. Sometimes you can get nitrides, though. So sometimes you use something else, like argon, a noble gas. And so, in other words, you put an inert gas in here so that the metal doesn't become oxidized, because when a metal becomes oxidized like this, you form an oxide coating, which is called a ceramic, and it becomes brittle, easy to break. Try this. Take a brand new light bulb, break the glass. Actually, don't try it. And then, because if you were to put it in, it's just going to last, you know, it won't last very long, and I've done it. But actually, because of electrocution hazard, don't do it. But anyway, that filament oxidizes so fast it turns into a brittle ceramic and it just breaks immediately. And so you got to watch out. So anyway, this is pretty much light bulb, and we call this piece of metal here, or the light bulb, a black body emitter. You know why they call it black? Because black, you know what black objects, you know what color black objects absorb?
All light
colors. So a black body absorber absorbs all colors, and a black body emitter should emit all colors. When it emits all colors, it should be white light. When something absorbs all colors, it should be
black.
Now, why is it emitting light? Like this piece of metal here, why is it emitting white light? It's emitting white light because electrons are getting excited. And the electrons are getting excited to all these energies, right? In other words, what we see is we see a continuous spectrum. Continuous because all colors of light are being emitted. We get the full rainbow, Roy G. Biv, and we get white light. Continuous because the electron can be excited to any level. What else has electrons? Well, all matter has electrons. And so what somebody did next was they tried to make a light bulb, not using metal like this, but using a gas tube filled with hydrogen. What is hydrogen made out of? One proton and one electron, you know, the most common isotope. And so you have one proton, one electron. We don't want to burn the hydrogen, but we can excite it. We aren't going to excite hydrogen with a flame, because you know what that's going to do? It's going to cause an explosion. But we can excite it using an electric discharge, like a little lightning bolt. And so we could hook it up. What that is, it's a transformer. Generates a very high voltage. Very high voltage is like a lightning bolt. You can get air to conduct electricity. You see it all the time in lightning bolts, right? As long as the voltage is high enough. And so that's what they did. They made a light bulb out of hydrogen. Hydrogen has an electron. The electron should be, you should be able to excite that electron, you know, through the whole range of colors. If you excite the electron through the whole range of colors, pretty soon, you know, you get a whole range of excited electrons, which eventually calm down to start emitting all colors of a rainbow. And a hydrogen lamp like that should emit white light. It should emit white light, but it doesn't. Did that hydrogen emit all the colors of the rainbow?
No.
And so, unusual light pattern because the electron in the hydrogen atom couldn't be excited to any frequency. There were a lot of forbidden frequencies, and there were only four. You might not have seen four, you might have seen two or maybe three, but it turns out there are only four allowed. frequencies for that hydrogen atom. And so basically what it means is the hydrogen can oscillate at this frequency, but it can't oscillate at that frequency. In fact, it couldn't oscillate at a lot of frequencies until it hit the next allowed one. And so each time you saw a peak there, that was an allowed frequency for the hydrogen. Here, red. Here, green. Next one was blue, and the tiny one in violet. Only four allowed frequencies. And so the question comes up is why? All you have is a proton and an electron. And so why can't that electron oscillate at any frequency it wants? Right? Just like the electron in a metal. The electron in this piece of metal, can it oscillate at any frequency it wants? Sure. Why? Because the electrons are very loosely held in the metal, right? Very loose electrons. They can be excited a little bit, or they can be excited a lot, right? Well, isn't the electron in a hydrogen atom kind of loosely held? I mean, you have your nucleus and electrons occupying empty space around. Why can't it have any frequency it wants? And so that was unusual. The unusual light pattern shows you a lot of forbidden frequencies, a lot of forbidden energies for the electron in a hydrogen atom. And so the question was why? Because classical physics, which is, you know, Newtonian physics, didn't predict that. You know, classical physics, Newtonian physics, predicted that the electron in a hydrogen atom can adopt any frequency it wants. In other words, it could go any speed it wants. It's like driving down the road. If you're driving down the road, are there certain speeds that are forbidden? Well, there are because of the speed limits, but are there certain speeds forbidden? No. You could go anywhere from zero to whatever the maximum of your vehicle is, and anywhere in between, right? And so that's continuous. And so this is unusual because if the car is an electron, then it can't go any speed. You know, it could go, let's say, 20, or it could go 50, or it could go, but it can't go anything between. So do you see what's unusual? What is making the electron in a hydrogen atom have forbidden frequencies and allowed frequencies? It makes no sense. And so in experiment 3, we looked at a whole bunch of unusual light patterns because it's not just for hydrogen, it was for helium. Helium has two electrons, right? And so why? Well, and not only that, were the forbidden frequencies and allowed frequencies for helium the same as hydrogen?
No.
No, totally different, right? Sodium. And then the fluorescent lamps are totally different, and the solar. If you looked at the sun, were they forbidden and allowed, or was everything allowed?
Everything
was allowed, because when you looked at the sun, you have the full continuous spectrum of light, from red to violet, and probably some infrared, and probably some UV. But you have a continuous spectrum. And so the question is, why do some things have a continuous spectrum that is all allowed energies, like this piece of metal? This piece of metal here in the light bulb, was this continuous or discontinuous? This was continuous also, right? And there you have discontinuous. And so that was the observation, and then they tried to fit the pattern to some mathematical formula to see if they could get more insight, and they were able to fit it to hydrogen. But the mathematical pattern of hydrogen wouldn't fit any of these others. And not only that, they tried to fit some of these others to a mathematical pattern, but it didn't really work out so great. And so we'll continue with this after the break here. Let's take a break. After the break, can you check out the equipment? And then we're going to talk about spectroscopy.